everyone. Thank you for joining us for the last week of our Transform Groups. And to those of you meeting at either of our campuses, we're going to continue meeting like this, meeting in groups on each campus through our next series, Cultivating a Godly Marriage, that begins on Sunday the 8th. Now, if through these groups on campus, you found a group of people who became friends, and now you want to continue meeting in one of your homes, please do so. Meet and help each other, apply to our lives, whatever the Sunday text or topic is, to help each other become a better disciple of Jesus and help others become a disciple of Jesus. Now back to this past Sunday, we saw two encounters that rich men had with Jesus. Now doubtfully, any of us would have the income or wealth that these men had, yet it is important to note that although we don't have a top 1% wealth, I'd say 21st century Americans, we are among the wealthiest in the world, right? We don't go to bed hungry if we don't want to. We know the lights will be on in the morning. The house will be air conditioned or heated. The internet's gonna work, and we don't wonder where our next meal will come from. I mean, in my own house, I have a fridge in the kitchen, a fridge in the garage, and a chest freezer with half a cow in it. We could eat for a month without grocery shopping. We truly are rich. So 21st century American Jesus followers, we are the ones who have to pass through the eye of the needle. So what we'll do this evening is we're going to read these two encounters in the order in which they happen in Luke. And after each encounter, we'll take time around our table to answer questions that help apply the examples to our own lives. So let's begin with the rich young ruler in Luke 18, starting in verse 18. Luke tells us, a certain ruler asked him, meaning Jesus, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus answered. No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. Honor your father and mother. All these I've kept since I was a boy, he said. When Jesus heard this, he said to him, you still lack one thing. Sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. When he heard this, he became very sad because he was very wealthy. Jesus looked at him and said, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. Indeed, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. Those who heard this asked, well, who then can be saved? Jesus replied, what is impossible with man is possible with God. Now, it's easy to look at this passage and be either dismissive of or disappointed in this rich man. But isn't this the type of man we'd want our daughters to marry or the type of man we'd want our kids or grandkids to grow up to become? This is a man who grew up in a spiritual community. He kept the law, which is something most people found difficult to do. So let's not be too hard on this guy. And I'm going to offer up a bit of speculation about this man. I'm of the opinion that he either came to Jesus and posed this question, what must I do to inherit eternal life, to either get an attaboy from Jesus, right? Because he was a good church person, he kept the law, or he found his obedience to the law as beneficial, but lacking in an eternal life, meaning a rich, full life. And I believe he wanted a rich, full life. Yet when the rubber hit the road, when he learned that the cost was his possessions, we see that he truly valued his things more than this eternal life that he sought. He came to Jesus to get something that he wanted. And in the end, he wanted what he had more than he wanted Jesus. So what we're going to do now is get to a few questions. You can pause the video once the questions come up on the screen, and then we'll get to Zacchaeus and Jesus. I hope your discussion was honest and helpful. And the more honest you are, the more helpful it is. But before we look at Zacchaeus, I do want to highlight verse 26, the question, who then can be saved? I think the question behind the question really was, if this obedient and blessed was evidenced by his wealth, if this obedient and blessed man cannot be saved, Can a rich man be saved? That's really the question. Because remember, the promise of the Old Testament was that if you followed the law, you would be financially prosperous. So of all the people that should inherit eternal life, it should have been this guy. So those who heard this exchange, they asked, can a rich man be saved? And Jesus, like a good rabbi, finds an opportunity to demonstrate that the emphatic answer is yes. And that's where we meet Zacchaeus in chapter 19. The text reads that Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he's going to be the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Now, I cannot tell you how many times I have read that story, probably hundreds. And when I read it in preparation for this group, something new struck me. What did Zacchaeus experience while eating with Jesus? I mean, we can take a solid guess at what Jesus said, you know, repent for the kingdom is at hand. He said that all the time. But this must have been the first time in decades that Zacchaeus felt loved, that he felt like a person and not like a tax collector. I don't think Jesus preached him towards repentance. He certainly called him to it, and he loved him to it as well. So we're going to end with questions about this text. So I'm just about done. But I want to thank you for being with us through this series and for doing the hard work, for allowing your relationship with God and money to be poked at. And to be quite honest, I was not looking forward to this series. Yet as each week went by, with each testimony that I heard and each message that was taught, I became more and more convinced that this teaching was the right thing to do, and applying it is even better.